It looked like somebody was bent over and had their head in the window of the deer blind. It either heard me or smelt me, and he pulled his head out of the tent and stood straight up, and that shocked me. They don't make people that big.
The way it moved, almost as if it was gliding across the beach. I've never seen anything move like that in my life. They were screaming at each other in gibberish. It sounded like a language, and they were chuntering away back and forwards, back and forwards, back and forwards. I know what a bear looks like, and there is no way on this planet that what I saw were bears.
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sheriff?
Gia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him. Uh-oh.
This is longtime supporter and listener Melanie West, and you're listening to Sasquatch Chronicles.
Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you tonight, Sunday night. I hope you're doing well. I know we all seem to be dealing with this pandemic issue, and I hope wherever you're listening to the show, I hope you're doing well. Thank you again for being here tonight. On Friday night, I had John on the show for the members, and a very fascinating account. John's actually a hunter, and he would go up to this hunting cabin, and it was really neat to see the progression of the interaction between John and these creatures, because for the longest time John didn't even know what was going on. He'd be hit with pebbles, he'd be screamed at, there was weird things that happened to him, and it wasn't until they came up to his camper, started messing with him while he was in his camper, he went out, fired off a shot, and saw the creatures all running off into the brush. He didn't think he hit anyone, but it's fascinating behavior because you start to really see the revenge streak in these creatures. So John leaves Saturday night, or I think it was Sunday, he left for the week, and he was going to come back the following weekend. And when he came back the following weekend, there was a tree jammed down through the roof of his camper, right where he sleeps. And it looks like a big tree was just stabbed through this camper. And it makes you wonder if they knew he was in there or didn't know he was in there. Definitely a revenge streak. It's fascinating to really see the behavior and how they interact with different people. Tonight, we're going to be chatting with Luke, and Luke comes to us from Connecticut. He was out with a friend of his, and they kept getting paced in the woods, and it's this area that he goes out to, and it's pretty fascinating. They were paced in the woods, and they didn't know what was going on, and when Luke turned around, he saw a very large figure move on him. Then we'll be chatting with the guys from the new documentary, Into the 400. It's available on Amazon. We're going to be talking to Chris, Shane, and Randy, and they're kind of going to give you a background on this whole documentary and why they're out at this property and some of the odd things that are going on out there on this property. And then we'll wrap up with Jarrett. Jarrett was out on his own property in Pennsylvania that he owns. He was out there camping while being quarantined. And a very strange encounter happened to him in the middle of the night. He came across what he says was either a Sasquatch or the largest man he's ever seen in his life. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. And again, if you get a chance to check out sasquatchchronicles.com, you can become a member and get additional shows. Let's jump into it tonight. I want to welcome Luke to the show. Luke, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thank you, Wes.
Yeah, I appreciate you being here, Luke. And you know, as you and I were talking, a lot of people from the Northeast are pretty hush-hush. A lot of times they don't come forward. They kind of keep it close to the vest. And but I really appreciate you being here. You know, there's parts of Connecticut and New York and even New Jersey that look like Washington State. But, you know, let's go into your encounter. If you would you just kind of start from the beginning and tell us what you were doing and what happened?
So it was my 18th birthday, December 26th. You know, I want to go somewhere cool, somewhere different. So I decided to head up to Dudleytown. It's in Cornwall. And for those who don't know anything about it, it was a settlement and established in 1740. Sorry, I'm a little nervous. I don't know why. Just talking this story gets me all nervous. But so it was supposedly plagued by curses and suicide for those who've lived there. And they didn't live there very long, you know?
Yeah, I've heard about that place. I've definitely heard about that place. I'd love to see it. And don't be nervous. There's no reason to be nervous. It's just us talking, so there's no reason to be nervous. So what were you guys doing? Were you guys camping? Were you hiking?
No, we were just hiking.
Okay.
We parked at a motel and walked up to the, it's kind of on a cul-de-sac up a hill. I believe it's called Bald Eagle Hill or Bald Mountain Hill.
Okay.
But there's houses up that road and you get to a gate and the signs, no trespassing, you know. So we walk in it and maybe about a half mile, nothing's going on. And then that's when my buddy starts thinking that something's paralleling us, something's following us, you know, and I wasn't too concerned. We get a little further into the woods and, you know, I hear what he's talking about. I'm still not as concerned as he is, but, you know, we begin to hear it more and more and a little louder. And it sounds slightly bipedal, but it's far enough away where, you know, you really can't tell. But it really started when we were going down this hill. There's a hill to our right and then more like open woods to our left. And the sound of something paralleling us on the hill as we keep going just continues. So I decide I'm going to walk, stop, see if whatever it is stops or whatever it is just keeps going. So the first time I did it, we heard two steps after I stopped. So then we walk a couple more feet, stop, then it stops with us. So it's almost on to us. And then I do it another time. It stops, but walks 20 more feet, then stops. We listen, we hear it. We get to the point where we heard the noise stop. It starts again, goes another 20 feet, stops. And then when we reach it, it goes again. And that continued maybe a mile or so until it started to sound like it was coming from other directions, which that's when the real fear kind of started to set in. I don't know if it was one or more or really what it was, but after that, we just keep walking. I'm kind of determined to find the ruins if there is any left. And little do we know, something actually was following us. I get to this dry creek bed and, my buddy starts walking back. He's not having it. He's real torn up about whatever's following us. So he's running back up this hill and around a bend. And I stop, close my eyes, look around, maybe let me see whatever's following us. You know, embrace the cold and the silence. And then I start walking back towards him, you know, and he's almost out of sight at this point. And as soon as I'm almost back to him, something tells me, just turn around. I look, and right where I was standing on that dry creek bed was something maybe 6 feet long arms. It kind of resembled like a shadow more to me. You know, it might have been the darkness, but kind of resembled just a figure of something, you know. And it took a lateral step to the tree next to it, which is about 3 feet away. And that was just the swiftest, most fluent movement I've ever seen. And it was gone as soon as I turned my body. It was already behind the tree, basically. So, yeah, that was the first experience.
And so you guys just kind of left at that point?
Yeah, as soon as I got back to him, I was like, I just saw something bipedal. We got to get out of here. And, you know, I faced towards where I saw it, and he faced the other way, and we just booked it.
Yeah, it's very common behavior. You hear a lot of these things pacing people when they're going down the trail, and they'll stop when you stop, they'll move when you move. What did you think was going on at the time? Do you think somebody was out there just screwing with you guys, or?
At first, when we weren't too far in the woods, I thought maybe it's someone who lives nearby, you know, doesn't want these kids in the woods. But as soon as we got a little further in, I knew it was something, it wasn't good. It didn't, you know, I felt dreadful. I felt very, very scared.
And you're right about the movement, you know, how they move, just how they move in general is very fluid. So it was more or less kind of an outline that you saw of kind of a taller something with long arms and kind of following you guys through the woods. Did it, at what point did it stop? Was it when you got back to the car, or did it keep following you guys?
After I saw it go behind the tree, I didn't see it anymore, which is even more perplexing to me, which, you know, you kind of think you'd see it sticking out from the tree, but its shoulders kind of were parallel to the tree, so it wasn't sticking out. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's really unnerving. What did your buddy think was going on? Did you guys talk about it after this?
Yeah, we did. And we do a lot of abandoned buildings, you know, psych hospitals, all that stuff. So he's more on the side of something paranormal.
I gotcha. Well, tell me about the second incident. Was it kind of in the same area?
Yeah, definitely in the same area. It was in a town called Warren, Connecticut. It was at the Wyatenoic State Forest. It's very rarely visited, just a big plot of land. I think it's like 12,000 acres, I believe. You know, it was July of this year, and I was really trying to get out, so I decided I'm going to do some solo hammock camping and try something different. And I had my girlfriend drop me off. I had no phone. You know, I brought just enough for the night. She dropped me off. It was maybe 4 or 5 o'clock. Stayed for a few hours, and as it started getting dark, I noticed things were picking up in activity. I was on rocks, almost like a little cliff face. I was near a pond as well. And what got me is when it got dark, I heard a duck just sound like it got mauled. Something went in the water, heard splashing, and then right up the hill where I was standing, just out of sight. After that, it was a little quiet, but I did hear things from other sides of the woods, kind of sounding like it was checking me out. At that point, I was pretty concerned, just because whatever got that goose was definitely not friendly, you know. I didn't get to see anything, but what drove me out of the woods was a grunt that just sounded like something was releasing all the air in its body and just sending it towards me. It gave me the chills. It sounded up high too, which was really weird. It sounded at least, you know, 10 feet in the air. I mean, I thought maybe it was a bear coming out of a hole in the tree, or I don't know, you know. And I packed up as quickly as I could and left those woods with my back to where I heard that grunt and just left. I mean, it was dark at that point, and I've never been as scared. I mean, I'm even getting a little nervous talking about it.
Yeah, what do you think that scared you so much?
You know, I think it was the fact that I was alone. It was dark. It was an unfamiliar area. And that grunt, it sounded like it just went through me. I mean, as soon as I heard that, I just thought of myself just falling asleep and something taking me. I mean, I was scared. I just, unreal.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know that they're brief encounters, and I still appreciate you sharing them. Do you have any plans as far as going back?
Yeah, maybe this summer, get a couple friends together, you know, but I'm not going back alone, you know?
No, I hear you, man. I hear you. What do you think that Sasquatch is, Luke? What's your opinion?
You know, my father's always said that it's an interdimensional being. I think I'd have to agree with something along those lines, just due to the fact that this thing turned behind the tree and basically disappeared. I mean, it was just gone. I mean, I think it might be something interdimensional, but I don't know, honestly.
Yeah, I hear you. Well, be safe out there, man. Be really safe going back to those areas. And sometimes it's best to leave. I think that grunt that people hear a lot, and it is loud, don't get me wrong, the grunt that they do, well, just like you described it, it kind of goes through people, you know, when they hear it. And it is terrifying to hear it. I mean, I've had hunters who have shot these things the moment they grunt. I don't think, and I'm not, and take what I'm saying very cautiously. I don't want you to let your guard down when you're out there. But I kind of, my impression, my opinion of the grunt is I think it's them acknowledging that you're there. I don't think it's necessarily meant to be aggressive, even though it sounds aggressive. Believe me, it sure does sound very aggressive. I kind of don't think that's what they're doing. But be careful. I mean, if you go back, definitely take people with you. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, of course.
And I appreciate you coming on, man, and sharing it. Thank you so much.
Appreciate talking to you. Thanks, Wes.
In 1984, I had an encounter with an upright bipedal hair-covered creature while alone in the woods of South Central Missouri. I wanted to know everything about these creatures. I was drawn into this enigma and could only hope to have another encounter. In 2017, an old friend brought me into a private property where there seemed to be consistent things happening, along with the property owner having some personal experiences. I created pattern hikes as to be predictable, and I looked for patterns being created to my own. This is the documentation of what happened and the experiences we had on the property that we now call the 400. Looking for the Ozark Mountain Sasquatch.
And next up on the show, I want to welcome the guys from the documentary Into the 400, which is available now on Amazon. If you guys get a chance, check it out. Into the 400. I want to welcome to the show Chris Reinhart. Chris, welcome to the show.
Good. How you doing, Wes? Hello, everybody.
Yeah, I'm doing well. Thank you so much for being here. And Mr. Randy Harrington, how are you, Randy?
Hey, everybody. I'm good, Wes. Thanks for having me, buddy.
Yeah, I always enjoy talking with you. I've had Randy on. Most of the listeners know I've had Randy on several times on the show. And I also want to welcome Shane to the show. Shane, thanks for coming on.
I appreciate you having us.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I got a chance to kind of preview Into the 400. I enjoyed it. I thought it was well put together, and you guys definitely have some cool evidence. The footprint evidence that you guys had is outstanding. But who wants to start to tell us about this property? I know Randy and I have talked about it in the past, but maybe Shane, if you'd like to start and talk a little bit about the property and how this project how the whole video came about, the movie that you guys put up on Amazon.
Sure. So, I got brought into the property. A lot of things were happening when I first got brought in. The owner of the property was experiencing a lot of stuff. He had, in the middle of the night, he would have something banging on the back of his cabin. He was having rocks thrown around his cabin at night, and with witnesses there, they would be out front, you know, barbecuing, and rocks would rain in on them, around them, not necessarily hitting them, but he had his flue almost completely torn out of the back of his cabin one evening. He was having, you know, little structures and whatnot would just pop up out behind his cabin in the tree line and in the woods. And a friend of his brought me into the situation. And one of the first things that I recognized was they had recently logged a little valley that was in his property. And a lot of the things that were happening with the guy that brought me into the property were happening in that valley at the time. And so I kind of put two and two together and thought maybe that was the reason that these things were happening. And the homeowner had actually witnessed one of these things during deer season, the first year that I was in there. And he had been hunting out of the corner of a barn, and he watched one of these things through a night vision scope come up out of the woods to the edge of the tree line and walk down the tree line. And that's when he realized what was going on. And that's kind of why I got brought into the situation, was to just kind of confirm what the guys were thinking out there, and try to help calm the situation down. the place is full of different areas of the property have different types of trees and whatnot. You know, there's a lot of hardwood, a lot of cedar. There's some pine, a lot of hills and deep valleys. There's a creek that runs through the property. So it's really prime area for these things to be hiding out, basically. I think it's possible that the logging is what kind of stirred everything up to begin with.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Randy talked about that, Shane. That was his take on it too, as well. I wanted to ask you, when the homeowner saw it, did he describe to you what he saw?
He did. He did. It was a large black mass. You know, he didn't see it. You know, super well. It was. I've stood in the corner of the barn where he witnessed it from, and the tree line that it came up to was about 40 to 50 yards away. And like I said, he was watching it through a night vision scope on his rifle. So he actually dropped his rifle, didn't even take it with him. It spooked him so bad. He dropped his rifle right there and ran out of the front of the barn, just hoping to get to his vehicle and get out of there. You know, it scared him to the point that he left his gun, you know.
Yeah, I think a lot of people can relate to that, you know, especially when you see these things. And so you get Chris and you get Randy to go out there. Chris, tell me, when you first went out there, what kind of things did you experience?
I never experienced anything like I experienced in the 400 beforehand. I was I just started off doing this and, you know, hiking around the woods here in Connecticut and trying to do my own thing here, and Shane brought me into this and brought me down into the 400. And after that first night in the 400, it changed my life like 360 degrees. It's the interactions down there were crazy. Just like I believed beforehand, but now after being there four times in the last 2 years, it's just opened my mind to a whole new scene of things.
Give me an example, like what kind of things changed your mind when you went into this on this property?
Well, the first night when we got there, we found the prints within an hour when we were there. And then we went out a couple hours later with Randy's flare set up and seeing the one popping its head out and popping up and down and checking us out. And then I was actually sleeping in a tent, and I can't say 100% this was a Sasquatch, but something walked up to the side of the tent and huffed on the side of my face, scared the living daylights out of me.
Yeah, that would scare me. And Randy, why do you think, is it still going on to this day? I mean, is the activity still going on?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. You know, for me, I've been involved in a lot of things up until this point. So when I got out there, and you can actually see this in my demeanor in the documentary, when I first got there, I just spent time at the campsite setting things up. I mean, I didn't run down to where they had the footprints at all, I don't think, until I think they went to collect them. So it's weird. My demeanor is often I'm standoffish until I ascertain what's going on myself. And I've got to be absolutely honest with you. It took me till we got it on thermal for me to be 100% bought into this property. At that point, I was just doing what I normally do. I go out and I just see what happens. But there's lots of hurdles that I need to jump myself in locations, because I've heard the same stories over and over and over again. So it really takes a lot for me to be bought into a place. And so that's why I was kind of standoffish to begin with, because I just figured, you know what, we're going to camp here and I'll be gone and I'll never be asked to come back. Nothing will probably happen. You know, those are my mindsets. But I'm telling you, from the moment that they found those prints and then we went back out there at 11 o'clock that night. And I mean, it was 100 miles per hour from that point on. These things, you could always guess and think about a Bigfoot, how they might follow and how they might peek at you. But we were getting that out there. We were seeing that in action. We were seeing how far away they are comfortable with. We were seeing them popping their heads up out of the grass, behind trees, throwing rocks at us as we're hiking up the hill, and keeping a certain distance away from us. So all of the things that I'd put together about behaviors in my mind because of the things that I've seen, not actually seen, but just experienced out there, you're seeing it in action. You're seeing all the things that you put together in a pattern. These things are showing themselves, and they're putting themselves in positions to be seen. They don't know what a thermal camera is, but we certainly have been using it to our advantage out there. And I am not disappointed one iota. And it seems to be almost every time we've gone out there. I mean, even the last time that Shane and I were out there, I mean, it wasn't, 100 miles an hour stuff, but it was still just enough subtle things, tree branches being broken. And we had two different recorders going out. And so from the sound of the tree branch breaking on the other side of the creek, it was further up the hill from the second recorder, because we got it on the first recorder, but it was at a distance. The second recorder, which was further up the hill behind the creek, it was much louder. So we can just surmise that it was beyond that, a little bit further up the hill. That's the same area we're getting tree knocks from. We think that they're, locating on top of that ridge. So I really think, because of the fact that they're there almost every time we go out there, it's just something we've got to take advantage of, because you never know when it's going to end.
Tell me about the night you got it on thermal. I think you've mentioned it before on the show, but maybe someone hasn't heard it. If you would, Randy, tell us about that.
Well, as you're going to see on the documentary, the technique that I work with my thermal is a little bit different than other people. And it's based on, to me, it's just based on logic. We know that most thermals are held in front of people's faces, and they look in the direction that the thermal is looking. So a timid, shy creature that's always worried about you looking at them is not going to be easy to catch, even with a thermal, because to them, you're looking in their direction. So this property actually gave us the opportunity to test out a technique that turned out to be great. And that is, the thermal camera on top of my walking stick and the monitor hanging at my chest allows us to spin around. And the moment we saw the one in the field as we were walking out towards the prints, I saw it. At this point, it was just a round heat signature. I mean, you couldn't see any more details than just something round, which is hard to even figure out what that is. I mean, your first take is it's a head, and it was sticking up higher than the grass. So when I'm looking at it, and I tell the guys, I said, I think we've got one over there towards the creek, looking at us, in the grass. And the moment Chris and Mark turned around and came back, I think me and Shane were already looking in my monitor, but Chris and Mark were ahead of us by about 15 feet or so on the trail. They started coming back, and it was that change of direction, of them changing their direction to come back, that the head dropped really fast. That if you're looking at their behaviors, that tells you they are absolutely aware and leery of us moving in a different direction than we were moving, and that worried it. You could tell that it drops in a way that it worries it. So we got all that on thermal video, and it actually, because we turned our backs to it, it raised its head maybe three or four times total, and maybe one time it exposed a little bit of a shoulder, but it was just up and down. It would go up and down. But it would never leave that spot, and you could actually see the heat signature within the grass. So you could see that's where he was, and so you didn't need to look anywhere else. But if you waited long enough, the head would come back up. And so that's pretty much in a nutshell how that first thermal video took place.
For the audience, again, it's Into the 400 on Amazon. Shane, with regard to the homeowner, does he have the opinion? Because sometimes these homeowners, they want them gone when these things show up, and they always, at least I get asked all the time, how do you get rid of them? What's kind of his mindset with having you guys out here and then seeing these things on his property and having all these weird things go on his property? Does he have the mindset, like, how do you get rid of them, or what's going on with him?
That was his mindset in the beginning. At this point, everything, all the scary stuff that he was experiencing has stopped. So in his mind, you know, the fact that we're out there doing this and all that craziness at his cabin has stopped, it's kind of eased his mind. And at this point, it seems as though he's okay with them being there. He will not go into the bottoms of the property where we camp by himself. You know, he's fine as long as he has somebody with him. He won't go down there at night, but it's not a place that he, you know, normally went a lot anyway. So the fact that that's where we typically find them, I think that's kind of eased his mind up too. But he's definitely more comfortable at this point than he was. And I don't think he wants them gone. I think he is just okay with, you know, giving them their space and him having his.
Yeah, I hear you. Do you think that they backed off of the home because their focus now is on you guys?
You know, I'm not sure. I've had that thought, absolutely. You know, it could have just been a time thing. They, you know, like they let him know that they were irritated and, you know, there's been no more logging or anything at this point. So, you know, it could be a number of things.
Well, I mean, just for the benefit of listeners, of people that are listening, there was a friend of the homeowners who was coming out there and he'd go back there and throw rocks back at them and yell and scream and whoop. And we're not saying that that had anything to do with it, but it very well could have. You know, a lot of people think that going out in the woods and making calls are the proper thing to do without really knowing what are they challenging them? Are they, you know, what are they doing when they do these calls? You never know. So that could have had something to do with it. The friend of the landowner doesn't do that anymore. So that could have been part of it too. You just never know.
Yeah, that's a good point, Randy. That's a good point. And, you know, one of the other questions I wanted to ask you, and any one of you guys can take this, is there just one creature on this property, or how many creatures do you think are running around on this property? And, you know, just kind of your opinion or maybe an educated guess.
Well, the educated guess would be that I have consistently found four sets of tracks on the property. And that's not to say that there maybe isn't a fifth one or a sixth one. All we can go off of is the amount of tracks that are, you know, the separate tracks that we found that are different sizes. I have seen one of the individuals three times at this point. And last year, we were in a position about 100 foot away from a juvie that was pinned down in the grass. And I actually walked out to it while Randy and Dan Nedrelo, who is a biologist, witnessed and filmed. And Randy actually, you know, I kept my flashlight off most of the time, and Randy had to kind of lead me out using the thermal to where this thing was. And the one that was there, I don't believe is the one that I had seen previously. So I believe that was the youngest one with the smallest tracks that we find. So just due to the tracks, we pretty well know there's four individuals on the property, two juvies and two adults.
And Chris, I wanted to ask you, when you're out there and you're on this property, is there any fear as far as this thing coming in?
Be honest.
No. Yeah, there for me, definitely there is fear because I never experienced any of this stuff before. I've only been doing this for 3 years now. But I got two of the best teachers and out there with me now, and I'm starting to, you know, to relax a little bit. These guys are more interested, I think, in us than we are them. They're actually coming into the campsite now while we're there and, you know, coming to us now and checking things out. But I definitely have the fear. I don't like the midnight hikes through the woods, and I don't like the stones being thrown at us while we're going up the trails and that kind of stuff. But slowly but surely, I'm hopefully turn that around this year. And it's just different when you know that they're there. You can see them, and you're like walking next to them in the pitch dark, and you don't know how they're going to react or any of that. So to me, that's it gets me the chills. But these guys have calmed me down a lot since day one, and hopefully that continues. I'm still learning, and I'm getting taught by two of the best.
Yeah, Chris kind of got thrown into a situation he hadn't had any up close and personal experiences, and me and Randy have both experienced that, so we're a little more comfortable with this situation. Chris kind of got thrown into the fire, so to say. He came in with no real experiences per se, as far as, you know, witnessing things and experiencing these things, especially at night. So he came in, and literally his first trip out here, you know, he was experiencing all these things. And for I think for the average person and for most people, it's almost like an overload situation. You know, it's one thing, like you hear about people going out and having an experience and they have PTSD from that one experience. Well, Chris came in and had like five or six experiences the first time he was there, and has continued to have these experiences with us every time he comes out. So he had a lot thrown on his plate right from the get-go. So, you know, that can be tough for a person, but he's slowly but surely working himself through that. And, you know, he's playing his role, and we all kind of have a role within the group. And Chris has his, Randy has his, and I've got mine. And we have Dan Nedrolo, who's a biologist, involved now. We have a second biologist involved now that is actually going to be writing a paper that he's going to put through the peer review process. And the paper is going to have to do with our tracks. We have about almost 50 track castings that we have at this point. And that's just a portion of the tracks that we could have poured. We've just been pouring the best tracks so far. So we're trying to bring some science into this also. You know, it's not just hey, look at this, look what we got. We're trying to bring some actual science into this, and we're starting to get some people that can help us along with that, you know, reaching out to us.
Yeah, and how would someone reach out to you if they have an expertise, Shane? How would they, how did they contact you?
They can contact me, Shane Carpenter, on Facebook, or Randy Harrington, or Chris Reinhart. My email is hybridmma74@gmail.com. It's another easy way to get in contact with me.
And Randy, when they're throwing rocks at you, does it irritate you? I mean, do you get the impression they're doing that to get rid of you or deter you? What's your feeling on that rock throwing behavior?
No. The rock throwing is never, it's never had that effect on me. It's just a fascination when it starts to happen. I'm enthralled because I know we've got something going on. But before I talk about that, there's something that you asked before that I'd like to throw something in on, about how many creatures you think are out there or beings. Like Shane said, we know for a fact there's four that keeps the same prints keep showing up over and over again that shows there are four. But when we had a lot of activity that one weekend when we were out there, we were out in the field, and I don't know if we were filming that belly crawler or what, but we were out in that field filming one with the thermal camera, and it was like 10:30. You could actually hear us on the recorder out in the field because I was whistling to get them to stop the Polaris so I could get out and start filming. But the recorder that we had across the creek going up this trailway at 10:30, something was removing rocks and tapping on the recorder. So that was all at the same time. And so it made Shane and I have a conversation that night around the fire where we were talking about the possibility or the probability that we're dealing with more than just the four family members. We don't know that. We can only extrapolate what we can from the evidence that's given to us. But we can logically jump into some probabilities just by the evidence that's given to us. Something removed the rocks and tapped on that recorder. So we were thinking, because of the size of the juvenile's footprints, which were starting out at about 8 and 9 inches when Shane first started, now they're up to like 9 and 10 inches. They're two different sized juveniles. They could be, and Shane was talking about it last night on a show that he was doing on the Ozark channel, but it's either twins that were not identical, if it's a boy girl, maternal twins or whatever you call those twins, paternal twins but not identical because the footprints are about an inch different in size. So it could be male and female, but if not, then it could be siblings with that are about a year apart in birth. But how long does a Bigfoot go before having another baby or another, you know, do they procreate all the time and then their bodies just has babies whenever they can, whenever there's enough food? I mean, I can't imagine that they would have family planning discussions where they say, hey, our children are not old enough, so let's not have any more. They may have those conversations. I don't know. But I think in all likelihood, we've got some younger juveniles out there that just hasn't been allowed to come down into those areas that leave the footprints. You know, the mama may even have an infant or a toddler that she carries around that just hasn't, you know, just haven't found any tracks yet. Something's telling me that we're going to start getting some evidence that proves that there are some other siblings involved out there that are younger than the ones that are leaving the 9.5 and 10 inch tracks now. But it's just a guess. But I think it's a logical and a very smart assessment on our part to, you know, as we get that information.
And Randy, what kind of vocalizations are you getting out there? I mean, what are you guys hearing? Is it whoops? Or I mean, what are the typical vocalizations that you guys hear out there?
Any vocals are very scarce. And a lot of, you know, we're going to misinterpret a lot of owl calls. Everybody always has those misinterpretations. So we can't say for certain that every vocal that we hear is not an owl until we see one doing it. The only thing we can count on is the nonverbal, you know, the tree knocks and when they happen and why they're happening, to know that they're up there communicating in nonverbal ways. I'm telling you, we're going to be lucky if we ever catch a conversation that these things are having. We're trying to put the placements of our recorders in places that we think that they might retreat up on the ridge. Once we find the spot where they don't go any further, and we can catch some recordings of them behaving amongst themselves up there, we might get lucky and catch something. But we just got to keep playing with it.
I have actually caught a few whoops out there. I've heard several that I wasn't able to capture, didn't have a recorder going at the time. But Randy is correct. In this particular area, they don't seem to be really, really vocal. It's mostly your rock clacks, wood knocks, and you know that seems to be most of the sound and audio that we capture.
Do you think that they're not vocal because you guys are there and observing? Do you think that's why they're not so vocal in that area?
Not necessarily, because the homeowner hasn't experienced a lot of vocals either. And he lives up on the top of the property, and sound kind of echoes down and up through these hollers. So, you know, I would expect him to be hearing this stuff when we're not there, and that's not really the case.
I got you. Well, let me ask you this, Shane. For someone to go on Amazon and get into the 400, what can they kind of expect when they go to watch your guys' film?
Well, so this was the first time that I brought the guys in for this. So basically it's a real in the moment filming of the evidence that is common out there. I literally expected things to shut down when I brought guys in, and it didn't. It did the opposite. It actually heightened. And so, you know, there's foot tracks, there's thermals. We had an apple that was bitten in half. We had you know, a lot of stuff. There's a lot of technique that people can draw from and use themselves that is working for us. It's a lot of different things that you're not seeing from other documentaries at this point. We got really lucky. We've been really lucky.
And what are you hoping to accomplish out there, Shane? What's kind of the end goal?
Well, you know, one of my things, and this is just more on my side of things, I'm into tracking. I love tracking. So one of the things that I'm working on is consistently getting the tracks of the two juvies from year to year so that we can show the growth rate, we can show the morphology change in the feet. I've been saying for a long time from my previous experiences that their feet don't look like the adult feet, that their feet morph into the big flat feet over time. And as of right now, the tracks are starting to show that. And that's one of the reasons why we have this new biologist involved, is because he's had that theory for a long time, and he's had these discussions with Meldrum, and he has a different opinion than Meldrum. He just hasn't been able to prove it because juvenile tracks are kind of rare. There's not a ton of juvenile tracks that have been casted out there and that are available. And, you know, here we're sitting on almost 50 of them. So now this biologist has something to go off of, and what he's seeing in our tracks is, you know, what he expects according to his theory, which is, you know, real similar to mine. So that's one of the main things that I'm focused on as far as scientific evidence. As far as, you know, what's to come, you know, I hope to be getting within 10 foot of these creatures on a consistent basis in interacting and in building, for lack of a better term, a relationship with these things, to where they're so comfortable with this that, you know, me and the guys can be out there and be 100 foot from them, and two of us can walk out and sit 10 feet from them and, you know, maybe give them snacks and whatnot. And eventually, you know, we want to have up close and personal footage and prove to the world that these things are real.
Yeah, I hear you. Chris, why do you think they're so hard to get on film? I know you guys got them on thermal, but why do you think they're so hard to get on film out there?
That's a tough one to answer, Wes. I think they're the masters of their domain. I think if they want to be seen, they'll be seen. I think with what's going on at the 400 is just like a place. I've done a lot of research on a lot of this stuff and looked at tons and tons of other researchers and investigators, and this just doesn't really happen. Like Shane was talking about the prints before, they're actually, we're seeing one of them grow. I mean, her feet, we think it's a female, and we think it has a crush on Shane. She does. So, but her foot is actually flattening out and getting it, the toes are very similar. So you're seeing that aspect. I think if they want to be, if they want to interact with you during the daylight and they want their picture taken, you can get it. And I think it's going to take a long time, and it's going to take that trust. But I think it can happen. I think it's all on them. I just think it's all on them. If they want to be photographed, they'll be photographed.
I hear you.
Hey, Wes, do you mind if I throw a little bit in on that?
Yeah, of course, Randy.
Well, we've got two thermals from two separate locations. One I got down by Bennett Springs in Missouri, of a juvenile with a specific behavior. And the fact that I caught it in two different locations, and one was out on the 400, and it was the juvenile that Shane eventually walked up on. When we first saw it, we didn't turn our backs to it. That was when Nedrello was with us, Nedrello, and we were facing the small one in the grass. So unlike the first thermal, which we all turned our back to and got him to pop up several times, we got excited. Dan was with us, and we were really, really excited, and we were facing this one. And because we were facing it, it exhibited the exact same behavior of the one I was facing at Bennett Springs when I was filming it. And that is, it was frozen, but it was slowly dropping its head, and the movement was so imperceptible, you couldn't see that it was moving, but you could see that it was starting to disappear, but it was slowly dropping. And eventually it dropped all the way down. And that's when Shane started walking out there because we waited and waited, and it never brought its head back up. But that behavior will tell you, they think we can see in the dark. They don't know that we can't see as well as them, and they can see pretty good, I think. So when you're facing them, they have a behavior that we were able to witness it with a thermal camera. But during the daytime, you would never see that. You'd never see them. They move in a way that you just wouldn't see it. And the fact that the daylight that they're out and about is three or four, you know, a couple of hours before sundown and maybe a couple hours after sun up. You know, all the other times they're mainly nocturnal. So you're real limited in your daytime opportunities to catch them. And even when you can catch them, if that behavior shows to be true, you're never going to see them, man, unless you've got some equipment that's going to get you where you need to go with this.
Yeah, I hear you. And I like your idea with the thermal. You know, a lot of times there's been a lot of encounters where people point things at these things and they seem to, I don't know if they think it's a weapon or what, but a lot of times they'll back off. So having the thermal on that walking stick is pretty brilliant, really. And I could imagine you'd get away with kind of scanning and looking down, and probably looks like you're doing something else besides filming what you're filming. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and we've tested some of these concepts while we're using the thermal. We were on a place that we call Crawler Hill, and we were filming one, what we think is the adult male. And we had our backs to it, and it was stepping out completely in the open between two trees. And it was almost like it was pacing back and forth, like it was irritated. Chris and Randy spotted it and was looking at it, and they saw its arm fling like it was throwing a rock. When we all grouped together and turned our back, it was coming out in the open. And at one point, I got up and turned to grab my backpack to get a drink of water. And when I turned, it reacted, and it jumped behind the tree. And that particular night, it was like you couldn't see your hand in front of your face if there was no light whatsoever. If we didn't have the screen on, looking at the screen, you couldn't see nothing. It was pitch dark. It was it was super hot, a little cloudy, no moonlight. So, you know, that proved to us right then and there that these things absolutely can see super well at night. And it's not
like your behavior, Shane. You actually weren't, you didn't turn up the hill and face it. You just grabbed your backpack. You just got up from a sitting position and grabbed your backpack. Just that movement alone was enough to put it into hiding mode. So I'm telling you, these things are, they're going to perceive any movement as a threat to them. If, you know, I think that's just in their nature, and that's worked so well for them.
Yeah, he looked worried that one. He was pacing back and forth. He didn't know what to do. He's seen us, and we're all sitting down there on this flat rock, and I don't think he knew what to do. He was just pacing. He was worried about something. Either a little one was nearby, or who knows. But that was another. That was the second night, Wes, I was there. Two nights in a row, we're catching them on thermal, 60 yards from us. And pretty amazing stuff, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. Shane, is there anything else you want to add to it?
We will have a part two and part three coming out. And, you know, this started in 2017. We've spent, you know, the last 2 years, the guys coming in and out. And so we've been filming this whole time. So we will have a part two that follows up and a part three that follows up. And some of this is me out there by myself, just continuing to do the things that I do to try to progress this whole situation along. And then the guys come in and, you know, and we try to get, you know, the good stuff. So there will be a part two and a part three following up.
I can't wait to see it. And for the audience out there, definitely go check out Into the 400 on Amazon. See the guy's evidence and kind of the whole story behind how they ended up on this property. And I wish you guys success out there. I really do. I sincerely mean that. I would love for you guys to come back and so I can finally improve this thing so I can finally go do something else.
Hey, I just wanted to say we appreciate everything that you do for the community itself, you know, bringing this subject to light. The number of people that you have that are open to this subject now is pretty darn amazing. So, you know, thank you for what you do, and it helps people like us out in the long run.
Thanks so much, Shane. Definitely check it out. Into the 400 on Amazon, and check out Shane's channel, Ozark Mountain Sasquatch, on YouTube. Very cool channel. Guys, thanks so much for coming on.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you, Wes.
Thank you.
Guest tonight is Jared. Jared, thanks for coming on the show, man.
Hey, thanks, Wes. I appreciate you.
Yeah, I appreciate you being here. And I know you kind of had a scary encounter out at your property. Before we get into all of that, Tell me, what was kind of your opinion of Sasquatch? What was kind of your take on the whole subject prior to all this happening?
Well, I was pretty agnostic about the whole situation, actually. You know, I've had a couple friends and my uncle told me stuff, and I never really, like, actually gave any thought into it. I find it hard to believe that it's just a regular ape that we're unknown of. I kind of lean towards the paranormal side. Not paranormal, but, like, there's a lot of encounters where aliens and Bigfoots are in the same things, or they're both encountered at the same time, you know? I've always been, like, I'm not somebody that's going to say a definite this way, a definite that way. All I know is that what happened to me, like, a month ago was really scary.
Yeah, I hear you, man. Well, let's do this, and we'll come back to that question. So you're out in Pennsylvania. If you would, for the audience, just kind of tell us what you were doing and walk us into what happened, if you would.
Sure. I live in Pittsburgh, and I have a campground about 2 hours north of there in Venango County. I go out there 2-3 times a year just to camp or hunt. I haven't hunted recently in a few years, but I still go out there to check on the campsite and check it out. And with the quarantine, I can't do anything on the weekends. Can't go to the gym. So I went up there end of last month, just cutting firewood, making a big campfire by myself. Had a good time, made some campfire pasta, went to bed in a tent. So 4 a.m. rolls around and my car alarm starts going off. And, like, I don't even know how to start my car alarm. I've tried to unlock it before with the door being locked. I mean, we've been playing hockey and I've ran into it and nothing's going on. I don't even know how to even set my car alarm off. So 4 a.m. comes around. I'm confused. I have my gun in my tent with me. And there potentially are some black bears up there. So I roll out of my tent. I shoot one into the air. I really don't see much until I approach my car. And the only light I can see is the periodic blinking of my car. And when I finally get to my car, I see, I'm going to guess, an 8-foot figure, not walking, not running, striding casually, I would say, out of the area. And I didn't see any facial. It was walking away from me, all black, no like neck features. Like, it came down like a triangle. It scared the shit out of me. And what I did is I hid in my car with my gun. I laid in my back seat until daylight. As soon as daylight came, I sped out of there as soon as daylight came. And me and my buddy are going to go back next weekend. It's been about a month now.
Yeah, be careful going back. And, you know, seeing this thing kind of striding off, you know, first time you told me this encounter, I was thinking, well, why didn't you yell out to the guy, like, what the hell are you doing around my car? But I guess if you see something that's like 8 feet tall and built like a triangle, you're probably going to keep your mouth shut. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I was by myself in the first encounter and I was like kind of dazed, like 4 a.m. waking up in a tent. Yeah. I had no idea what was going on. You know, I figured like a branch had fell on my car or something.
What do you think that this thing was doing? Do you think it was trying to get into your car? Or, I mean, what was kind of your impression as far as what was going on?
Well, I'd been up there all day. I got up there probably like 9 a.m. and I started building a campfire. And I was also like trying to like, I had my rifle and my handgun on me. And I was also like shooting guns, trying to like scope my gun in all day. So like if anything was around, they would have known. But that I was there all day. I was cooking. It's my property. I have 22 acres. I wasn't like thinking about anybody else being in the area, you know? And I just went to bed figuring that I'd wake up and gather all my stuff. And I haven't been back there since. Like, I waited till daylight and sped off after that encounter. So I'm excited to go back there and see if everything's still pristine and where I left it or not.
Did you ever get a chance to look at the car, see if there was, like, greasy handprints or anything odd around the car?
It's a Chrysler. It probably shouldn't be in the back roads anyway. Like, it kicked up a lot of mud, like, just getting back there. It's not like a... It's like about a mile run road to get to the campsite. So it already had mud and stuff kicked up on it. And like, honestly, that was the least concern in my point of frame and my mindset right then was like looking at the car for handprints. It was already covered in mud, just like getting there. And then when I left, at the break of dawn, I just left, and it's like a 2-hour drive. So,
yeah, no, I get it, man.
I definitely didn't fully examine my car.
Yeah, no, I get it. And that's understandable. I mean, it's not like you're trying to prove the existence of Bigfoot at that point. You're just trying to get the hell out of there.
Yeah.
Was there anything that stood out to you when it was going, when it was striding off? Was it just appear to be a large man, or was there anything that really stood out to you beyond the height?
The only light that I could see was the blinking of my car alarm. And I probably only got like 3 or 4 blinks, and it definitely didn't have any neck structure. It came down like a triangle. You know, you can see that sometime when somebody's wearing a hoodie. And honestly, I don't know what's scarier, an 8-foot guy hiding in the woods with a hoodie on, or like there's potential black bear up there where that's pretty much why I had my gun. But if a black bear is going to be running away, they're not going to run away on 2 feet. And when I'm looking at it, like my number one concern is get in my car and lock the doors, you know? So I only got 2 or 3 blinks of my car alarm headlights. So I don't know, I was like freaked out. I laid down, I put my gun on my chest and waited till daylight. But you know, how many, I don't know, it's just like an estimation. I say 8 feet, maybe he's 7'2". Who know, you know, like I was panicked at the time, but yeah, definitely the tallest man I've ever seen. I was just in a panic. Got in my car, locked my door, had my gun on my chest, and hoped I didn't have any altercation.
Yeah, I understand. I understand, especially being alone and up there and everything. Mm-hmm. Be careful going back to that area, man. I always tell people, be careful. You know, I know when you saw it, it was kind of heading off the opposite direction, but sometimes they don't head off the opposite direction when you encounter them. So be really, really careful going up there. And you can blame it on me. Say Wes is a wimp that told me that. You know what I mean? But just be careful going.
Yeah, I'm going up there with my buddy next weekend. I have to check on my campsite. I mean, I left a lot of stuff up there. Normally I'd spend 45 minutes breaking down my campsite and all that kind of stuff, but
yeah, I get it, man. One of the things I wanted to ask you was, you know, obviously this would get you to kind of look into the subject, and I ask everyone, what do you think Sasquatch is, and what's kind of your opinion?
I'm kind of agnostic on the whole situation, but I find it hard to believe that this is just some kind of undiscovered apes species, like especially with all those sightings also coincide with alien sightings. My uncle told me like this when I was a little kid, and like I've never really like got into it, you know, really thought about it. And then I've got a lot of downtime, and I've just been like listening to stuff. But like the amount of Bigfoot, Sasquatch stories that also coincide with UFO sightings kind of like makes me lean that way. I find it very hard to believe that it's just a purely undiscovered ape species. I don't know if you want to get into it, but like, I don't have a concrete answer for you.
No, and that's okay. I was just kind of curious what you thought. I mean, you know, some people are hardcore believers that it's some ape running around, and some people look at it and go, nah, I think there's something else weird going on here. And then you'll get to the opposite side of the coin where, you know, they're communicating with these sayings and it kind of goes out into bizarro land. And I think somewhere in the middle is the truth as far as what these things are.
Yeah, that's why I'm agnostic. Like, I don't,
yeah,
I'm not 100% one way, but if I had to like tilt the scale one way, it would not be an undiscovered ape. It would be something else is going on.
Yeah. And I get that where you're coming from on that. And I kind of lean that way sometimes too, you know, as far as if it feels like there's something else going on here, beyond just an ape, but you know, who knows? No one really knows. Please be careful when you go back up. And will you let me know? I know you're going to go up next weekend with your buddy. Let me know if anything happens when you guys go up there, will you?
Yeah, I'll send you an email. I'll let you know if anything's different with my campsite. Hopefully it's still intact. And like, I don't even know. I told you earlier, I don't know what's scarier. Like, if there's an 8-foot guy in a hoodie, an all blacked out hoodie. And honestly, those are like the crappier hoodies when they just go straight to your shoulders instead of coming down to your neck.
Yeah.
Like, I don't honestly don't know which one's scarier. I don't want anybody on my campsite. Like, it's just in the middle of nowhere. Like, there should not be anybody out there besides deer and skunks and bobcats, you know.
I get it. Yeah, definitely let me know if anything else happens out there at that property. And I really appreciate you taking the time to come on and share it. Thank you so much, Jared.
All right, thanks for having me on, Wes. I appreciate you.
And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out sasquatchchronicles.com. You can become a member and get additional shows. Until next time, everyone. Something a quiet time with the lights on.